Good evening. Oh, that's so amazing. Welcome to the Pratt Library. I'm Darcel Graham, interim CEO of the Enid Pratt Free Library. And thank you. Oh, well, thank you. Thank you so much for joining us for this special edition of Pratt Writers Live featuring Dr. Sharon Malone. We are so thrilled to have you join us for this special event surrounding women's health. At the Pratt Library, it is our role to spark important community conversations, and I'm glad we're able to host this program. I want to thank our great and honorary donors who makes this program free and possible for all. Thank you. We have a huge lineup, I'm sure of which you've probably already seen, but I just want to remind you a little bit. On April the 24th, we'll be welcoming Bakari Sellers to the stage. He will discuss his new book, The Moment, with the White House correspondent, April Ryan. The very next night, we're having former Obama White House Social Secretary, Deisha Dyer, will be here with her memoir, undiplomatic. Yes. Thank you. On May 2nd, bestseller Eric Lawson will be here to discuss his book, The Demon of Unrest, in our Grand Central Hall. Make sure you don't miss a program by picking up your free copy of our Compass magazine or check us out on prattlibrary.org. Now, to get tonight's program started, boy, do we have a special guest for you. She and her family have been longtime supporters of the Pratt Library, and it is my pleasure to welcome the First Lady of Maryland, Dawn Moore.
Thank you so much, Darcelle. Good evening, everybody. Look at Baltimore showed up. I love that. Yes, give yourselves a round of applause. This is such a beautiful room and such a wonderful time to be here. I also see my family in front, so I want to say hello to them. But this is a very special evening, even you know, for you, of course, and for me too, because I'm getting the opportunity to introduce two friends. So before I do that, I would like to bring greetings from my husband, the 63rd governor of the state of Maryland. As you know, he is the first African-American governor in the history of this state. He is the third in the history of this country. And he is the only sitting Black governor in the country. And although that may mean we have more work to do, I just want to tell you, you have the right leader at the right time. Thank you so much. And so I am truly honored to welcome you here to the Enoch Pratt Free Library. And as we kick off Black Maternal Health Week, we come face to face with sobering data. In Maryland, Black women are 2.5 times more likely to die during pregnancy, twice as likely to die from cervical cancer, and 39% more likely to die from breast cancer. We see similar disparities nationwide. And in 2024, Black women continue to be misdiagnosed, undiagnosed, and underdiagnosed. And I remember going to see a doctor in my late 20s. I was having a double vision, my gait was off, and I'd lost the taste in my mouth. And the doctor told me that I was having a nervous breakdown. And I knew that wasn't right because I knew my body, and we as women, we know our bodies. And I was later diagnosed with multiple sclerosis. And I know many in this room have similar stories. So today we are going to take our health into our own hands. We are joined by two phenomenal women who are going to help us do just that. First, we are honored to have Sharon Eiffel. That's right, give her a big round of applause. Sherilyn is known by many titles. I'm gonna talk about her like she's not here now. She is former president of the NAACP Legal Defense Fund. She is a lawyer, educator, wife, and mother. Sherilyn is a nationally recognized expert and leading scholar on voting rights and the judiciary. She founded one of the first law clinics in the country focused on helping formerly incarcerated individuals re-enter society. In 2007, her 2007 book laid the foundation for contemporary conversations about lynching and reconciliation. Sherilyn is a proud Baltimore native and a dear, dear friend. And as a personal point of privilege, we were also honored to have her speak at my husband's inauguration. So thank you so much. And so now, our next guest, tonight's author, Dr. Sharon Malone. Yes, please be welcome. Everyone should have some walk-up music, right? But I'm so excited just to talk a little bit about before this book and Dr. Malone before they start the conversation. But as you all know, she has released her first book, Grown Woman Talk, just 2 days ago. And boy, can I tell you, she has been city to city to city. And I want to tell you that she loves seeing so many people here. She's been, you know, having great crowds all across the country, but Baltimore showed up for her tonight. So give yourselves another round of applause. The book draws from Dr. Malone's decades of experience in the medical field, including her roles as chief medical officer, advisor, obstetrician, gynecologist, certified menopause practitioner, wife, and mother, and friend. Dr. Malone is a nationally recognized expert on women's health and a vocal advocate for menopause awareness. She has dedicated her career to eradicating health disparities for women of color. Dr. Malone describes her book as part medical handbook, part memoir, and part sister girl cheerleader. I'm in the middle of reading the book, and Dr. Malone has captured things that I've felt for years. Feeling ignored and unseen in the healthcare industry is not something that we should have to cope with. And the music lover in me appreciates the music lover in her, which you will see throughout her book. So be prepared to be empowered about your health tonight, your womanhood, and your agency. Let's give them both a round of applause.
Thank you so much, First Lady. Thank you. And thank you all for being here. This is amazing. When my husband was dropping me off, he said, you know, should I come to the talk? And I said, you know, tonight the women are talking. I'm very happy to see some men in the audience. That's fantastic. But excuse us for a minute while we have this talk, which I think is really important. I did want to correct the First Lady. I am not a Baltimore native. I'm originally from New York. And that will play into, hello, hello. But all of you know that when I moved here more than 30 years ago, I have embraced Baltimore as my own, and I consider this my home. Okay, so Dr. Malone, I am so thrilled with this book. I will tell you, and I shared this with her really within a day of getting the book. I posted something on Instagram. As you can see, my book is ready for this conversation tonight. And when I got the book, I said, let me just take a look at it, you know, right before I go to bed. And I got through half of the book. I made myself shut it and put it down because it was so compelling and so accessible and so spoke to me. And I really want to start where you start. What you said in the very beginning of the book was, start talking. Start talking. And a key part of this book is breaking through silence. So can you just share with us what you meant by that?
Sure. Thank you very much, Sherilyn. And I have to say thank you to the First Lady of Maryland, because this, we couldn't have asked for a more auspicious start. So let me tell you a little bit about why I wrote the book and why it was important and why I even named the book Grown Woman Talk. You know, I am the youngest of 8 children. My mother was much older. And there was always this time in the day when my mother would sit around, they'd be in the kitchen table, and her sister would come in, and then they would start talking, and their voices would get a little low. And then they would look at you, and they would say, okay, this is grown folks talk. Now, I didn't know what they were talking about, but I know whatever they were talking about sounded really interesting to me. But they wouldn't allow us to be part of that conversation. And I think about how much of that wisdom that I didn't get to have, because my mother died when I was 12 years old. And I think about, wow, what was that grown woman talk? So this is what I wrote this book with the intent that it would encourage all of you to talk intergenerationally. If you have the opportunity, you still have your mother or you have elders or older sisters, talk, ask questions. And once you ask questions, you would be surprised what you may find. And we've got to talk more amongst ourselves, because I think that we as women suffer in silence about a lot of things. And you don't understand that if you just brought it up, you might be able to help someone, or at the very least get some support that might be very critical for you.
You know, it's so interesting because we also may be replicating what we experienced. So are we sharing with our daughters and our nieces and our granddaughters our experiences, or are we now putting ourselves in the position that I'm the youngest of 10, so I have you beat by 2. And there is that separation of conversation. And the first thing we can do is make sure that we're not perpetuating that, that we're being transparent about what's going on with us to that next generation. Although when I try to tell my daughters, they're like, mommy, I don't want to know all this. So, but in any case, I'm making sure that we do that. Now, you said in the beginning of the book as well that genetics isn't everything. How did you describe it?
I said genetics is not destiny.
Genetics is not destiny. And I wanted to start there because one of the sets of information we do get are just the pure genetics, right? Oh, your father had sugar. You know, your mother died of breast cancer. Blood pressure runs in your family.
Right.
You know,
we
get the doom and gloom of the genetics that I think frightens us. And sometimes leads us to misinformation about ourselves. So can you share what you meant by that?
It leads us to a sense of complacency, because you think that those things, just because they run in your family, that is your destiny as well. And I'm here to say, no, it does not. We share a lot of things in families other than our genes. We share our health behaviors, our lifestyles, the foods we eat, the things we do and don't do that may be inhibiting our ability to live our best lives. So take this into account. You know, there have been numerous studies, even with identical twins. You know, they have exact same genes. You put them in different environments and you can only get the genetics of the twins to concur about 60% of the time. And those are two people with the exact same genes. So I want you to know what your family history is, because it's important. I think that what you inherit is not just your genes, but you inherit what you are susceptible to. You know, and I use this analogy a lot. I said, you don't get to decide what cards you're dealt, but you do get to decide how you play them. And that may be the beginning of the end.
Say that one more time. This is a card playing crowd here. Say that.
You know, you play your hand wrong, you're not going to win. You know that. But that is really the case. I want people to understand, and this is a message that I hammer home again and again and again, that you have more control over your health outcomes than you think. So don't just sit there and think, oh yeah, sugar runs in my family. Well, how about this? And you'll find that, you know, I have a lot of homespun tales, and my people were old, and I'm from Mobile, Alabama. And so my mother would say a whole lot of things, but I would say this to you. What your family history tells you is, I said, it gives you an idea of what you need to look out for. And think about this. If you are driving down the street and it says road out ahead, do you put your foot on the gas and keep going? Or do you say, well, let me at least slow down? But what I want you to do is not just slow down, but turn that car around and realize you don't have to go down that road.
There is another path.
There is another path.
Well, let me just ask this question of the crowd to kind of set up this next part of the conversation. How many people here are between the ages of 25 and 35? Okay. How many people are between the ages of 35 and 50? How many people, watch this, are age 50 and above? Okay. So, I ask this for a reason. Because you were just talking about that car on the road, and I suspect that the path we would take having seen that sign up ahead might differ depending on how old we are. So I would really love for you to go through like the top three things if you are 30, the habits that you want to get into or the things that you want to get hold of if you're 35. The things, because some people will listen, you know, like when people say, what you need to do is you need to eat, you know, the vegan keto something, and you need to work out five days a week.
Right.
And you're like 65 and you're like, listen, something else, you know? So there has to be different. So, but if you're 35, there's certain things you can do. If you're 50, there's certain, and then what should you be thinking about? So could you just take us through the ages?
All right, let me say this, because I think that the younger you are and the earlier you start these healthy habits, the more benefit you're going to accrue. But there is no point in time in which you say, well, don't even bother. You're going to accrue benefits no matter whether you started at 25 or started at 55 or 75. But just know that you're going to get more bang for that buck if you started earlier. And let me say this. It's not hard. It's that, you know, the things, you know, that I'm going to tell you, it's like, okay, oh, let me take notes. No, exercise, eat a healthy diet. And when I say healthy, I don't mean anything special. More fresh fruits, more vegetables, more fiber in your diet. This isn't, you know, so you don't have to do anything special or go, sign up for a special meal plan.
Well, why does fiber taste nasty?
Pardon?
Why does fiber taste nasty?
No, you get fiber in your food. In your food. Let me just say, because, no, I want you to understand that food is medicine. My mother knew that. My grandmother knew that. That was what they had to really combat a lot of the things that would befall
us. You talked about your mother, because I had this experience too with my stepmom making you have cod liver oil
all the time. Yes.
People had the cod liver oil. Yeah. Rough. But that's a perfect example.
You know what? And I was probably 40 years old before I had any idea what was I taking cod liver oil for. I just remember I was like, ooh, we had to take it in the morning before you went to school. And my mother would give you a big spoon of cod liver oil. It's vitamin D.
It's making me sick. My face is set up right now.
You know, because the wisdom of elders, let me just say, they knew a lot of things because they did not have the option of going to the doctor. You know, my mother grew up in rural Alabama. There wasn't a doctor to be had, nor was there a hospital to be had. So all that collective wisdom of the generations of how to treat, what to do, all of that stuff, you know, we've lost that. Because this is the first generation, I think, of people who think that they know more than their parents. You know that.
Say that one more time. Say it again. Where are my children?
Oh, you know, and you would know this because if any of you have had children and your mothers come in and your mother will go, what are you doing? Girl, give that baby some cereal. And they're like, no, mom, it'll kill him. I can tell you for a fact. I can tell you this for a fact, and I will get off my family stories. But I was born in 1959. And I was baby number 8. So I think by the time I was born, my mother was done with it. She was like, I have breastfed my last child. And that was 7 years ago. So she was done. And I said, well, what did they give me? No, there was no Similac in 1959. This is what constituted.
Hold up.
Exactly. Mom would buy, she would get carnation milk. Some Carol syrup, water in a bottle. Now, I'm still here, people. So I'm just saying. I'm here.
I love that. I love somehow you survived.
Somehow. Well, this and I is don't
true.
Have peanut allergies either, by the way.
Oh, truth. You know, this is true. I mean, this idea, and that's what I love about the book, is it is a mix of taking on the new and right. integrating the received wisdom, which is its own wisdom, and which is, they may not know all of the scientific reasons right. why you were taking the cod liver oil, but they knew you needed to take it. And so you want to factor that into, okay, so you're saying that those three things are true no matter what the age.
I'm going to, yeah.
Yeah.
We'll go through. It's like five or six. the obvious. Don't smoke. Smoking is bad for you or any number of reasons. So if you don't smoke, you exercise, you eat a healthy diet, get a good night's sleep by any means possible. If you have high blood pressure or diabetes, it is vitally important that you treat them. You can't take your medication one day and save it for another day. It's vitally important because there's a reason why we call high blood pressure the silent killer, because it is. So, you know, these few little things that you do, you would be surprised how much they're all interrelated. And if you do one, it affects the other, because if you don't get a good night's sleep, guess what? You're tired, you're fatigued the next day, you're not going to exercise. Now you're going to gain weight. Now you're going to have high blood pressure. Now you're at risk for diabetes. And, you know, just sort of figuring out one of these things, just sort of break that cycle. And these healthy behaviors that I ask you to do, eat, sleep, get exercise, just if you did those three things, I promise you, you will come out on the other end healthier than when you started.
Can you talk about medicine? Because you just mentioned it, and I think we have to have a really transparent conversation about our relationship with medicine. First of all, many of us, and just systemically, we have uncomfortable relationships with the healthcare system. So Black people can be simultaneously under-medicated and over-medicated. If we are honest with ourselves, we also sometimes take matters into our own hands, which you were alluding to. I take it every other day. Mm-hmm. I took it the first time, but it made me tired, or it made my stomach hurt, or it made my head hurt. Rather than going back to the doctor and saying, it made my head hurt, right? We will stop taking it. Right. So I wonder if you could just spend a little bit of time talking about when we are in a situation where we have to take medication, what we can do to build a relationship with how we engage that medication for our condition.
Well, let me say that again, when we talk about the two big things that are killers in the Black community is high blood pressure and diabetes. I mean, that is just that is the cornerstone of so many things that cause ill effect as we age. I want to back up. And as you said, let's talk about when you're 25 versus when you're 55. What I want to tell you is that when you're 25, if you do these things, you may never get to the high blood pressure and the diabetes, or you'll at least get to it much later in life so you don't accrue the ill effects. But for goodness sake, if you already have high blood pressure, if you already have diabetes, you must take the medications. And you are absolutely right, Sherilyn. If a medication does not agree with you, that's not your opportunity to say, well, then I feel better not taking it. There's a reason why there are 50 different high blood pressure medications. You write down what your symptoms were. You say, all right, this was a problem, that was a problem. You go back to your doctor and you say, this didn't work for me. Find another one for me. And let me say another thing about just dealing with high blood pressure generally. High blood pressure, if you're going to go see your doctor twice a year, what you've also got to do is that you have to, again, I say be the captain of your own ship. Monitor your blood pressure when you're home, because even if you're feeling fine, if your blood pressure isn't controlled, how will you know? You don't want to wait another 6 months or a year until you go back for your checkup. These are just sort of check-in points so you know that you're taking control of how you get through this process. Maybe you need a different medication. Maybe you need more medication. But there are a million different ways. And don't let anyone tell you that there's one way to do anything. That's why they have so many of them out there.
Excellent. So one of the things that I think we have to talk about that anchors so much of this is stress. Mm-hmm. And this is a huge part of our lives as women and as Black women. And you tell the very, very powerful story of your sister, Vivian. For those of you who don't know, Dr. Malone is the younger sister of Vivian Malone, who was a civil rights pioneer. She was one of the students who faced down at the schoolhouse door George Wallace and was one of the first students at the University of Alabama. She had to go through that gauntlet and that experience of litigation to get into school. She was, you describe her in, you know, ways of as being kind of the person who could do it all. She was also stunningly beautiful. And had a regality and elegance about her that maybe masked a lot of stress. And so it's not only that we have stress, it's that we also sometimes are carrying that stress, and maybe it's even to the point of PTSD. And so I wonder if you could talk about that in relationship to all of these other health pieces, because that's sure. The elephant in the room.
Stress is, in your life, I wish I could say, eliminate the stress. Yes, why don't you? Life brings you a lot of things. And what you have to decide is not just figure out how to control the things that you can. And understand this, that there is no value, either physically or mentally, of not dealing with the stress that you have. And this is where I think it costs so much of us, our lives and our well-being, is because we mask it. We don't deal with it. Let me just say that there was never a point in time in the history where getting counseling or mental health services was ever part of what you did. We went to church, you know, you prayed on it or you talked to somebody, but we didn't really have the tools that we needed to deal with stress, because you just bottle it up and you keep it and the body remembers. And you pay a huge toll for that. And I think this was true of my sister. I think this was true of my mother. The same thing. I mean, the fact that I can think about, did I ever see my sister cry? Maybe. But I think about how in the world did she get through that environment? But she just would soldier on. Just like you said, she's straight face. That strong Black woman myth that we try to live up to because we've got to take care of everybody else. No, you know, I'm telling you right now. So if you can do this, try to eliminate the things in life that stress you out that you can control. Not everything, be it toxic relationships, be it toxic work environments, the people that you associate with, you know, the people who are doing that, you allow that. We take other people's problems and we make them our own. And at some point, and I can say this as a parent for sure, I have three children, and my children have gotten in the habit of, Mom, here. Now you make me worried about something you need to be worried about, you know?
Transference.
Oh my goodness. And now I got to hold on it. And I'm like, oh my God. And I'm thinking about it. I can't sleep at night. And the next day I said, well, how did that work out? And they're like, what? I'm like, so you have to, you know, decide what you're going to take and what you're going to leave behind. And I think you'll do yourself the world of good, but we get back to these things, these behaviors that I was talking about. Exercise is a huge stress reliever. Mm-hmm. You know, realizing that, again, a good night's sleep. And I'm going to say this to all my perimenopausal and menopausal ladies out there.
Speak.
Hot flashes, if they are disrupting your life and disrupting your sleep, you need to get that fixed. Because hot flashes are really not benign. They are really harbingers of things of impending heart disease. If you don't treat them, who can go 5, 10, 15 years without a good night's sleep? It's not good for you. So I say that there's a whole section in there that we talk about perimenopause and menopause. And let me tell you something about one of the studies. There's a study called the Study of Women Across the Nation. And what they did is they just observed. They had women who started in premenopause, and then they just watched them and, you know, took some surveys along the way in 25 years. And what they found was that for every objective measure of sleep and depression, Black women did worse. Even when you ask them, well, do you feel stressed, or do you feel, you know, like you haven't gotten a good night's sleep? And I go, no, I'm fine. And it's because we have normalized suffering. We've normalized feeling bad. And to do that blunts your sense of when there's something really wrong. And I'm here to tell you that there is a different path that you can get through life. And your expectation shouldn't be, well, I'm older and that's what happens when you get old. No. I'm saying you should set your intention and your expectations that I want to feel good at every age. I'm not going to feel bad just because I'm 60 or 65. If that's been your role model up to this point, then you need a new role model, because that is what I want for you. And that is what I talk about in this book so much, because I want you to prevent things, not just treat them after they're already in
effect. The woman is preaching a word to us tonight. So, yeah. And I love that I was looking for the line. I can't remember exactly what the turn of phrase was. You had said something about curating you talked about my cousin Gwen, because Dr. Malone and my cousin were very close friends. And you talked about how Gwen was able to say no.
Yes.
People would ask her to do things. And what would she say?
Oh, yes. You know how it is. This is one thing about being older that is actually kind of nice. That when people ask you to do something and you don't want to do it, it's okay to say no. You know, and I've spent, you spend so much time tying yourself up in a knot. Well, I'd like to, let me get back to you. Or, you're making up excuses and things about why you can't do it. And Gwen had the best line in the world. Someone would ask her to do something and she'd just go, very sweetly, she goes, no, I couldn't possibly. What do you say when someone says, no, I couldn't possibly? That's a real no. That's not call me back on Tuesday.
No, it is not. It is not. But you talked about in the book something like starving the toxic relationships in your life and feeding the positive ones or something. And I do think that this is also a source of stress, is particularly like our roles in families is a big deal. Say a little more about it.
When I was talking about, there is a section that I talk about just relationships. And I think the importance, particularly of women, of female relationships, because our friend group is important. And to have people and friends and female friends around you who nurture you and lift you up. If you have people and friends around you that are always, stirring the pot and causing trouble, and the phrase that I use, I said, sometimes you've got to Marie Kondo some folks.
That's it.
Say,
that was
you are it. Not bringing me joy.
Declutter. That was the line. I love it. Got to Marie Kondo your relationships. So I think we have seven minutes and 35 seconds left? And I'm going to take this time because I feel like we're having a grown-up conversation. We have time and we can say these things out loud. We are now going to talk about our vaginas. The chapter's called Get Your Vagina Together. And I think we should be able to have this conversation.
I think we
you
should.
You are an OBGYN.
I think we must.
And I invite you to hold forth on how we get our vaginas together.
Okay. Well, here's the thing about what happens to you in menopause. And, and we go into a lot more detail. But Black women are least likely to take hormone therapy around the time of menopause, even though we're most symptomatic. And we, even when we get the prescription. Doctors don't give it. They're only half as likely to be prescribed even when you complain. And then when you do, you take it home and you think, oh my God, this stuff is going to kill me. No, I'm not going to take it. And you throw it in the trash. You read that warning label on the pack. And here's what I was to say, is that the issue of taking hormone therapy, you can do it or not do it. But I really want you to understand that there are, if you start hormone therapy between around the time of the natural menopause, there are far more benefits than risks. So understand that. There is no connection. That whole breast cancer thing that we think we take ourselves out of the game because we say, well, my mom had breast cancer. This one had breast cancer. I understand that. I've had two sisters with breast cancer. That is not a contraindication to taking hormone therapy. And let me say this to Black women out here, because 50% of Black women a generation ago had hysterectomies anyway. So you could take estrogen without taking the progestin. And for Black women or women generally who take estrogen alone, if you've had a hysterectomy, you have a lower incidence of getting breast cancer and a 40% less chance of dying from breast cancer even if you get it while on hormones. So this is a long way around the block, but we're getting to your vagina in a minute now.
We're not leaving without it.
Anyway, so if you start taking hormone therapy, then you are less likely to have the things that we associate with vaginal dryness, painful sex, urinary tract infections that happen after menopause. So if for whatever reason you decide not to do that, every woman can and probably should use vaginal estrogen because that dryness and discomfort
is topical. This
is topical vaginal estrogen. It's low dose. So whatever you believe about hormone therapy, this is so low. Even if you've had breast cancer, you can take vaginal estrogen, because something that we don't think about, I mean, women's sexual function is important. And if you are uncomfortable and sex is painful, guess what? That's a very potent libido killer, because who wants to have sex if it's painful? No one. So I say that to say everyone should just say, you know what? Even if I've made that decision, I don't want to do hormones. Vaginal low-dose estrogen is something that almost every woman should have, even if you've had nary a hot flash. 85% of women will in some point in their lives have these, what's called the genital urinary syndrome of menopause, which is not just your vagina, it's the outside, it's the vulva, it's itchiness, it's irritation, and it's also the urinary tract infections and urgency, frequency. There's a reason why you see so many ads on TV for incontinence products, because so many people have it. And it's another one of those things that we don't talk about. You know, because again, we're embarrassed. I don't want to talk about it. It's just me. No, a lot of women have it. And so that's a first step of getting your vagina together. And you can do that at any age, even if you've, you know, say I'm 20 years beyond, because people don't necessarily associate that with menopause, but it is a direct, consequence of having not had estrogen in your system for many years.
What I loved about that section is essentially the message was, don't give up on your vagina ever.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? I mean, I think that we're trained to think like there's a period when it's like, hello, and then we're supposed to just kind of forget about it. And I really loved that reclamation. And I hope right. The younger women in here are hearing that too. Like, imagine the life of your vagina as being part of your full life, not that you just shut down at some point. So I loved that.
Exactly.
I wanted to talk about two other things that, you know, when we're in rooms with Black women talking about health, you can feel in the air. One is endometriosis, mm-hmm. and the other is fibroids.
Mm-hmm.
You know, these are conditions that mm-hmm. cause a tremendous amount of discomfort, pain, frustration, surgery, difficulty managing, and really interrupt the joy of life for many, many women. Can you talk a little bit about how we should be approaching that now?
Exactly. All right. So I'm going to take fibroids first, because fibroids are so common. 80% of Black women will have fibroids. Now, that being said, only about 25% of those will actually need some sort of medical or surgical intervention. But the fact that they are there, when I tell you that the healthcare disparity is pervasive, and let me take a moment here because I forgot, I'm going to say it at the top, this is Black Maternal Health Week. And we are all aware of the fact that there is this maternal mortality crisis in the Black community, that 2 to 3 times more women will die. Take any condition that Black women have, and that same disparity issue exists before you get pregnant, while you're pregnant, and after you're pregnant. So the same is true of fibroids. Even though we have, 80% of fibroids, the reality is that when our fibroids are diagnosed, they're bigger. They're more likely to cause pain or bleeding or discomfort. And we live with that. And I'm just, again, I made it very clear. Look, you think that's normal. It's not. And these are things that you have to get addressed. And the longer you wait, the bigger your fibroids get. So it's just a matter of knowing when to intervene and knowing what your options are for intervention. Because even when you come to surgery for fibroids, Black women are least likely to get minimally invasive surgery. because the first step is always, let's just go directly to a hysterectomy. And sometimes a hysterectomy is appropriate. Let's be clear, it is. But to have not had the full offering of just knowing what the options are, but don't wait. Don't wait forever, because the longer you wait, the fewer your options are on the other end. And then about endometriosis. Now, there are the things that we're taught in medical school. Now, the way endometriosis was taught when I was a resident was that endometriosis was a disease that thin white college-educated women got. Absolutely. And so that means that they're not thinking about endometriosis when they see a Black woman. You're here and you're in pain, and we know that Black women are chronically under-medicated and undiagnosed and untreated for their pain. But the average woman with endometriosis, because the symptoms are so varied and it's pain, it's hard to diagnose pain because you can't see it. With fibroids, you can at least see fibroids. Endometriosis, you can't see it on a sonogram. You can't see it on a CAT scan. And all I have is just your ability to tell your story. The average woman with endometriosis has waited 7 to 9 years before they have gotten a diagnosis. And it's not because they're not going to the doctor. You're going to the doctor and they're like, okay, try this, do that. And by the time, unless the endometriosis is really resulting in infertility, you are less likely to get that addressed. And let me say, and that's a lot of misery. That's a lot of misery for a lot of women. And I say this to say, I gave you some of the tools and the information such that at the very least, I don't necessarily want you to diagnose yourself because that's never good. But I want you to at least know what the things are such that when you go in and you see your doctor, you know how to be a good storyteller, because that's what it's all about. When you're trying to get your needs addressed with a doctor, it requires that you know how to tell your story succinctly, make the plot line clear. You can't say, well, then, and then on Tuesday, and then in 1972, you know, because we're never going to get to
it. Y'all know y'all do that sometimes, you know? Right?
Oh, that reminds me, you know. So go in there, be clear. And this is where I said it requires a little homework on the front end, because be clear about what you're going in there to talk about. If you're going in and you're coming for an annual exam, don't wait for the last minute and a half of the appointment to try to say, oh, by the way, because you're not going to get to it. And I know it's a pain, but sometimes you just got to come back, because you have to say to your doctor, all right, we didn't get to that, but I need to come back because this is what I want to talk about. You have got to be your own advocate for your health. And do not, and I'm going to say this again and again and again, because this happens whether we're talking about maternal mortality and statistics, and we all hear this, we allow doctors to tell us how we feel. And if you say, well, this hurts over here, and they go, oh, that's nothing. Well, I tell my patients all the time, if I couldn't figure out on the first run, I would say, you know what? If it bothers you, it bothers me. So how about this? We're gonna reconvene on this. Come back, take a few notes, tell me what the story is, and we're going to see the next time. And if I can't figure it out, then I'm still not going to tell you nothing. Then it's my job to figure out who to get you to that can figure it out. But don't allow someone to tell you how you feel. And there is a sense that I talk about in the book. It's called interoception. And it's a word that most of you don't know, but you know, we all know about the five senses, you know, sight, hearing, smell, and taste. But interoception is that internal sense that you have when you feel normal, when you feel balanced, nothing hurts, you feel good, you walk around. And when you allow your baseline to be pain or fatigue or whatever, you blunt that sense because you need to know when something is awry. You're normally not aware of your arm or your foot or whatever. If you are aware of it and it's causing you discomfort, that's usually a sign or a signal. So don't blunt that sense by just walking around all the time being chronically in pain or chronically fatigued, because you won't heed the warnings when you get them.
That's really good. That's really, really good. Changing our baseline. Are you telling me that it's question and answer time? Is that why you're here? No. Okay.
Okay.
So I can go on. So, no, I just, my question. Can you give us some real talk about the way the medical system works at this moment? So, you know, I think many of us are aware of the role of insurance companies in changing what healthcare is like. These conversations that we're suggesting we could have with doctors.
Yeah.
Doctors are moving us at a very quick pace often. And sometimes these are difficult things to talk about that requires a little bit of time. I like your advice about making preparation. Is that the doctor?
No.
I like your advice about making preparation before you go to the appointment, because right. It is true. You get in there and you feel like the doctor's rushing you or the nurse is rushing you, and you know things start going out of your head. So you have to prepare, maybe even have a written list.
Right.
But the system itself is such that this idea that you're sitting down with your village doctor and sharing your story isn't kind of how it works. So can you tell us a little bit about what they're thinking about, what stresses are on them, how we can get through to get the kind of care we want?
I'm going to say this. I'll say a little bit in defense of doctors. They're really not trying to do a bad job. That's really not their intent. A lot of times they don't understand. And more often than not, they don't know you. You know, you are dealing with a stranger. Things, you know, I worked in one practice for almost 30 years in one area. I have patients that I have seen through puberty, college, childbirth, and menopause. I've taken care of generations. I know your mother. I know your children. That is not the experience of medicine today. You are going to find that there is a constant churn in doctors. Your insurance might change. Your jobs might change. Your employer might drop one particular carrier and come up with the next, and you have to have an entirely different group of doctors. And imagine how hard it would be to try to explain yourself to a different person every time. Oh, and by the way, when you go to the hospital, that person who's been taking care of you, however, you know, long, they don't see you in the hospital. Now you've got a whole other set of complete strangers that you don't know how to take care of. So the point is that we have a flawed medical system that was never designed for women, and particularly not for Black women. So it hasn't really evolved to address those needs, which is why I want to give you the tools that you need. And let me say this. I think that if you are going to be, you have to understand that now a little bit more of the onus falls to you. And I think that you can do it if you knew what to do and why it's important that you do these things. And that's what, and I talk about very granular things like medical portals, and what does it mean? You know, why do you want all your doctors within one hospital system? Otherwise, you'll never be able to find your results. And I'm going to let you in on a little secret. Your doctors don't talk to each other. They do not. So you show up in a doctor's office and you're like, oh, well, didn't you get my records? No, they didn't. And if they're in a different system, not only did they not get them, they don't have access to them. And now you've wasted half a day trying to get whatever your needs are. So it's practical information. And let me say this, because I think that the way that medicine is going today, it's not going in the direction of getting more personal. It's not. So just be aware of that. And the only consistent through line through all of these things is you. So you've got to keep your records. You've got to make sure that you are efficient and effective. And I think that one thing that really changed dramatically was when doctors stopped taking care of patients when they're in the hospital. I mean, when you're at your sickest and you need the person who's taking care of you the most, you'll never see them. And a lot of times, and it's not because your doctors are being, you know, uncaring, more often than not, your doctor may not even know you're in the hospital. So your job, because you think y'all are talking, right? No, you're not talking. So you need to inform your doctor, hey, I'm in Hopkins or I'm wherever I am right now. You need to know this, because the notion that someone would pick up the phone and call to get your history is really evidently just too much to ask in today's world. And when we've never been more connected and it's easier to do it, but they just don't. So just know that.
So one more thing I wanted to hit on was our bones.
Yes.
And, you know, I think many of us are surprised to discover when we hit a certain age, a certain unsteadiness. And as you get older, the fear of falling, and, you know, osteoporosis, arthritis, all of the ways in which the very kind of infrastructure of your body is affected. And so I would love, just as you did earlier, to give us a kind of a timeline of what we should be doing
right.
for as young women, you know, as women in their 40s and 50s, and well into ourselves as seniors, because this is so important. And I think we all know, we've all experienced a relative who took a fall and then was never the same, right? This is really, really important to hold on to our infrastructure. So can you share
exactly.
something?
Now, here's another one of the misconceptions about osteoporosis. And that is, we're taught in medical school, well, you know, Black women don't get osteoporosis. Yes, they do. And the reason why there's a sort of a bizarre logic behind it. But the thought was, well, Black women are generally bigger and they have bigger bones. So if you start out with more bones, it's going to take you longer to lose it once you get to menopause.
That doesn't sound like science. Yeah. I don't know.
I thought
it was something about melanin and vitamin D. No?
No. Because that's one of the things that makes you at risk for osteoporosis. The darker your skin, the less you are able to absorb vitamin D from sunlight.
Okay, this is important information.
Also, Black women are less likely to just go sit out in the sun. You know, nobody's trying to get a tan but me, but you know, that's how that works. And so you are chronically vitamin D deficient. A lot of Black women are lactose intolerant. So the time to build good, strong bones is when you're young. You need calcium, you need vitamin D, you need exercise. But there is a genetic component. We all know people with small frames and large frames. I happen to have a large frame. So whether or not you're at risk for osteoporosis really depends on those things, your lifetime calcium, what's your exercise been, what frame do you have? Because a Black woman with a small frame is at higher risk for osteoporosis and breaking a bone and breaking a hip or having, you know, and all of us know, you don't need a sophisticated test. You know what osteoporosis looks like. If you have elderly relatives and now you're shorter and the next thing you know, you're bent over, you got osteoporosis.
And estrogen has a role to play.
Estrogen for women who reach the natural age of menopause, normally we sort of stay in balance with our bones. Our bones are constantly being remodeled. You build them up, you break them down. That's why when you break a bone, you can fix it. But when you get to menopause, that balance, you start to lose more bone than you build back. And that's why as you get older, you get the bones get thinner, more fragile, more susceptible to fracture. If you take hormone therapy, and I sound like I'm advertising for it, I assure you I'm not pro-hormones, I'm anti-suffering. And let me say this, for osteoporosis, the only medication that is FDA approved for the prevention of osteoporosis is estrogen. Bar none. The other medications that you get, they're treating osteoporosis after the fact. They don't prevent it.
Can estrogen treat it after the fact?
No, but it prevents it. Oh. So it's the same thing. Once you've lost the bone, it's gone. So trying to get it back is more difficult. But here's the other thing about osteoporosis, and I think that most of you have dealt with this or have relatives who have certainly been in this position. Once you have fallen and you have broken a hip, surprise, Black women do worse in the aftermath of a hip fracture, you are more likely to be to lose your mobility, your independence, more likely to end up in a nursing home, and more likely to lose your life to complications that set in because of the immobility and being in nursing homes. So I often say sometimes a hip fracture is the next to the last thing that happens before you die. So if the thing is, let's not have a hip fracture, that's an easy enough thing to address. But again, not after you fractured your hip. Let's back it up 20 years and do all those things, the calcium, the vitamin D, but not a, calcium doesn't prevent osteoporosis either. You just need it because it's a natural, you know, it's a nutrient. But the things
and
that
you take it with vitamin D. So you take vitamin D alone, or you have to take the two together, right?
If you get good calcium in your diet, you don't need a supplement. Your goal is to get about 1,200 milligrams of calcium after menopause. And if you drink milk, eat yogurt, have cheese, you know, have broccoli, all the things, eat almonds, things that are calcium rich. Do you need a supplement? No. Remember, supplements are there for a reason. They just supplement things that you don't get in your diet. Preferably get it from your diet, but taking, it's not like what we used to do with vitamin C where you say, well, I'm going to take 2000 milligrams of vitamin C.
Used to.
Let me tell you what happens if you take 2000 milligrams of vitamin C.
What?
You pee it out in the toilet is what happens. You can do what you like. Doesn't hurt, but
listen,
okay, sorry.
Listen. You chew that vitamin C and you rub that Vicks. You know what I'm saying.
But let me say this. But too much calcium is problematic. So that's why you should never take more than the recommended daily allowance for your age. Because too much calcium can cause calcium stones in your kidney stones, constipation, stomach upset, and also arguably can cause calcification in some of your blood vessels, which is problematic.
So listen, only take the minimum. In this final minute, we are going to end on a positive note.
Yes, we are.
And the note we're going to end on is, I really would love for you to work with us on three things we can do this week. I'm going to provide one that comes out of your book.
Okay.
You said that the benefits of getting vitamin D from the sun, you need at least 20 minutes.
Yes, you need at least 30 minutes a day, but you need to have skin exposed. And it's just,
okay.
That's why.
So it's getting warmer.
Let me say this. Right? That's why your mother gave you cod liver oil in the winter. She didn't make you take cod liver oil in the summer
because
you were covered up in the winter.
Yeah,
see, your mother knew things.
She knew things. We can do this now that the weather is getting warmer. Even if you're not going to stay out just try to give yourself 30 minutes in the sun to absorb that vitamin D and to make that a habit for this summer, right?
And it lifts your mood, being outdoors. If you're outdoors, don't just stand there, walk.
That's number two. So we've already got two. Okay. One more thing we can do, like beginning this week.
Easy. All right. Now, I'm not the food police. But try to eliminate as much processed food as you can from your diet. Because processed food, let me just say, I dare say even call it food. I don't know what it is, but it's a concoction of, you know, chemicals and salt and sugar and things where there are people whose job it is to sit in a lab with a white coat on and mix stuff up to go so they can say, bitch can't eat just one. I'm going to put some more salt and a little bit more sugar. We put all these things in food that don't belong there. And the problem with that is that when you ingest this food, it disrupts your intestinal flora. Your body literally has no idea what to do with this stuff. It makes you sick. It makes you fat. It makes you feel bad. And there is just ample evidence that even says that it contributes to heart disease and cancer. So what's processed food?
It's not Skinny Pop, is it? Skinny Pop is okay, right?
I don't know.
I think it's okay. I think it's, I mean,
You know what would be better? If you popped your own popcorn.
Because but then I put a lot of butter on it.
Because here's the thing about processed foods. Processed foods have chemicals in them for a reason, so that it extends their shelf life. You're not supposed to eat cookies that are 6 months old, but you can. You know, try eating some cookies that you baked 6 months from now and see what'll happen to you. You know, so I say that to say this, all of these unnatural concoctions, and you don't have to be, you know, the galloping gourmet. You know, it's simple stuff. Have some fruit. You know, don't drink juice. Don't drink orange juice. Have an orange. You know, the same thing. Eat as many foods as you can in their natural state. And, you know, and we know that there are some societal problems because we know that there are communities that don't have access to fresh fruits and grocery stores. And that's another thing we've got to work on, because that's a policy. That's an issue that we need to address as a society, because there's also no accident that the places where the health is the worst is in food communities deserts, that have the least access to fresh air, outdoor space, and fresh food. So, you know, these are things we can do, two things at one time while we're waiting on this societal overhaul that may or may not come. Just understand that every little bit counts. You can do, you know, start small, and promise you, you'll feel better and you'll be better.
Let me tell you, this book is fantastic. I know we've had this conversation, and so you're thinking, why do I need the book? I've heard everything. No. I need you to buy this book. It is such a fantastic read. It feels like an intimate one-on-one conversation. This is the mother's gift that you are giving out this year to your friends and to your family. Please join me in giving a wonderful round of applause to Dr. Sharon Malone.
And you know what? We forgot the fun part. There's a fun part to this book. At the end of each chapter, there's a playlist.
There is a playlist.
So if it gets too heavy, go put your music on. It'll be all right.
Don't go anywhere. Wait. Hold up. Can we take questions?
We are at 10 after 8, so unfortunately not tonight. But
did you feel like your questions were answered? Did you feel it? I feel like it.
Dr.
Malone will be signing books, so please make sure you get in the line.
Can everyone please help me thank tonight's moderator, Sherilyn Eiffel? And again, Dr. Sharon Malone. Dr. Malone will be signing your book outside. You all have a free copy. Please look for Pratt staff outside. She'll sign outside.